this terminology here of the same. Same was in the beginning of the job. The same was in the beginning of the job. All right, and so what we did was we went through a few scriptures, and I asked you to just go through and just take a look at some scriptures in light of what we've shared and see if it made any difference. And I've had a few comments from people who did that, and I was really blessed. Jerry went through his computer and had a little printout of the same throughout the scriptures. And that's good stuff. So we're going to start this class by just kind of going through a few of the scriptures that I had, just to show you that, you know, that these little two words together, the same, many times you would just simply just read it there, but it would really have no meaning. Certainly would not be a reference back to the original seed. It wouldn't be a reference back to the total thought and concept of God. It wouldn't be a reference to Christ. It wouldn't be Christ. It would be something about him or about the subject, you know, whatever. So what I want to do is, in light of what we've been sharing, just look at a few scriptures. Let's turn first to chapter 15 of the Gospel of John. Now, of course, I really don't know everybody's translations here. So I'm going strictly by King James translation, scope of the Bible. Yours reads differently, and they translate out Jesus in your Bible. That's all right. John 15, verse 5. I'm the vine. Notice, Steve Mallett mentioned to that in the class, if you've been listening to the class I taught on the I Am, and I said, it's exactly the same thing. It is. The I Am and the same are the same. And it really is. It's the same truth. It's really a powerful thing. So that's why it's interesting. Verse 5 here starts, I am the vine. I am the vine. Ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Now, what did you always read into that? That you bring forth fruit. Okay, but it says the same brings forth much fruit. Okay, and that's got to be true, because he already said, without me you can do nothing. You cannot bear fruit of yourself. Did it say that? Okay, but it says that, and we turn right around and ignore what he just said and read that we can bear fruit. You see what I'm saying? I mean, it's like, you know, I don't know, we're just reading stuff that it says, and we're not really even challenging the scriptures, and I mean that in a certain way, because the scriptures add up, but you're actually challenging your understanding of what the scriptures are saying. So you challenge it when it says, wait a minute, it says the same bringeth forth much fruit, I thought, without me. And then, so the only conclusion you can come to, if you didn't understand the same, is, well, of course, being in union with him, it is his life in the branch, and that's what brings forth fruit, which is understanding this truth, whether you use the terminology of the same or not. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it really is the same truth, because you understand the concept. I'm a branch. If I'm not in him, life isn't going to be in me. Without life flowing in me, I'm not going to bring forth fruit. So the real source here is Jesus. We call him the same. But in my opinion, understanding this terminology and understanding it as spiritual, God-given terminology, even, can help cut down on a lot of that, by simply reading. The same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. The same. All right. And to take it a little deeper, there is no way first of all, it's always the fruit that we're after. We're always after the fruit, and that's what we think that this whole thing is about, the fruit. But it's not. Fruit is a manifestation of the spiritual reality that God is after. The same, or the complete thought and concept of God, brings forth fruit. Of course it does. Of course it does. But is the fruit what he's after? No, the fruit will be an automatic of embracing the total thought and concept of God, but to embrace thoughts and concepts about God may never bring forth fruit. So the answer to fruit is to understand the logos.
We're after fruit on it, but it's almost like fruit is a manifestation of what God is after.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
And I believe that. Now, the Father is glorified if you bring forth fruit. Why? Because he's glorified in this union between you and the Son, Christ in you, the whole glory, not just Christ. So in other words, it's not just the Father and the Word, which is his Son, which is another title called the same. They're in the beginning. And forget creation, don't bring forth anything. The only thing God's interested in is the same anyway, is the Word anyway, the complete thought. So what's the purpose of creation? Well, the purpose of that is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Not just Christ, he already had Christ. I mean, you know, Jesus was perfect. Jesus never failed to make it. But the difference is that he could not recreate his Son, but he could birth you, or create you, and then birth his Son in you and get more of his Son. And for those that would receive him, to as many as received him, they had the authority to become sons of God by Christ. Because, see, the only way you become the son of God is receive him. To as many as received him, they had power to become the sons of God. So while we put the emphasis here, because without him, you can do nothing. Never, never, never separate yourself from him. And this is what we do. We're either separated over here, going, oh, he's too good, no, nothing, or we're trying to be as good as he is. But you're one with him. And of course, this seems to be the same thing I'm talking about again. But you are one with him. You must break the old patterns of separating yourself from him, because in the Father's mind, you are in the beginning. And you have no beginning until you are in, and therefore one with him. There is no beginning. It's just you outside of him, and outside of him, you know, I always think of the holy city of God in the book of Revelation, and also described in Ezekiel and several other places, where this is where an outsider or murderers and da-da-da-da and all this kind of stuff. Let me tell you, it don't matter what you are. If you're not of him, if you're not in him, and if he's not, you're not in union with him, then he may love you, but there's nothing he can do for you. Now, he did it through the cross. He died for you. He forgave you of your sins, and then he joined you to the most irreplaceable thing and most valuable thing you could ever be joined to, and that's Jesus. So to think in separateness in any way, shape, or form is to ask for trouble. It's to place yourself outside the city. We could only be really out there in the way the scriptures say, only, mutants are out there with us. We would rush back in and identify as Christ. But we don't see each other as mutants. All this stuff, we see each other as, because we measure ourselves by ourselves instead of measuring ourselves by the same. So, they're real good. Oh, this person, Paul said, don't measure yourselves by yourself. He said, when you do that, you're not wise. Don't compare. There's no need to compare. There are differences of gifts, but the same spirit. There are differences going on. But that was over in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And this is the time of the same. There are differences. Diversity of so operation, but that's the same. All right, John chapter 7, verse 18. Again, we may have to double check my references. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory, but he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. Okay, Jesus could have said, but because I speak the truth of the Father, I am, and really to say I am is okay. But he used the terminology, the same is true. And that's more than the same speaks the truth. The same is true. It is the total thought concept of God. You and I have been placed in it. We're not trying to get truth from Jesus the same. We're not trying to find consistency from Jesus the same. We are trying to know that we're in Him and to identify regularly with Him. But a lot of Christians are out there trying to, thank God He's the same. That means there'll be some consistency in my life in the way that we relate. Well, that's not it, because there won't be consistency, because you'll be inconsistent. So the greater truth of Him being the same is not His consistency, but the fact that you're in Him. And to the Father's heart, He is the same. It will never change, never be back. So the same is true. I thought this one was interesting. Matthew 24. Shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Well, okay, if He's the same yesterday, today, and forever, if He is the same, the beginning and the ending, if He is the same, the Alpha and the Omega, don't you think that the same will endure unto the end? And if the same endures to the end, the same shall be saved. Okay, how are you saved? Did God save you? Think about it before you answer. No?
Scripture says that we're saved by His life.
We're saved by His life. And we were placed in Christ. And you're not just, this is tough. People have a hard time with it. In this sense, God doesn't individually save you. He doesn't just come down here and do this little plan for you and say, He doesn't. I don't care what you think. Now, He might individually touch you by His Spirit and bring you into what all that Jesus accomplished, that anybody whosoever will accept. But He didn't provide an individual salvation for you. You just individually received it at one juncture. Is that right? Or did Jesus die for each one of you every time somebody got saved? He went back down on the cross and did all this stuff. Now, instead of Him doing that every time for you, He did it one time for all and put us all in Him. You're saved in Him. Lets people get on. You can step off that train anytime you want to. But if you get on that train is predestined to heaven, or if you, I would rather use the terminology to the Father, because that is more scriptural.
It really is.
But, but this train is going to go here. Okay. It's going to go, it's going to end up here.
All right.
So you get on, oh, I promise you, and after a while, you know, yeah, that's just, you know, you get tired of religion and you get all wrapped up in religion and not, and lose your first love, and then you go, this ain't going to come to you, you wander off. Well, that was your faith to cut you off from the reality of what's settled for you, because he's the same. But once you left the same, you're on a ride. You see what I'm saying? And somebody said, I hear this one all the time. Well, if you get born again, if you're born, you can't be unborn. You die. You know what I mean? You can't be unborn. I mean, I'm God's child, whatever. Yeah. You know, that concept is true. The only problem is that we don't understand the new birth. And that's why we say stuff like that. And we're already in danger by our terminology, because we don't even understand the new birth. Jesus said you must be born again. The scriptures describe that new birth as 1 Peter 1:23 is being born again of incorruptible seed. Is that you? No, you're corruptible. He is incorruptible. So being born again of incorruptible seed is the seed of Christ. Okay, that is the new birth. All right. So if you don't continue in his line, guess what? It's not the incorruptible seed. Another example I used is we were there in John 15. He said, I'm the vine, you're the branches. If you don't abide in me and me in you, first of all, you won't begin to bring forth fruit. And this is what we always read then. We're so terrible about the way we look at stuff. Okay, well, if I'm not bringing forth fruit, or as much fruit as I should, God's going to cut me off. He never said that in John 15. He said, you know, it says there, well, that those that are, you know, have not brought forth fruit, they wither up and everything, he comes and he cuts you off. And he throws you in a heap and you'll be burned. The others gather fruit, brings glory to the Father. We go, oh man, I haven't brought forth fruit in a while, man. I'm going to be thrown in a heap, you know, burned up in the end. I'm, you know, we don't even understand. You know, so what do? We go out and we go on a short-term mission trip. This will do it. Oh, praise God. We can do it. Well, in fact, we were never in danger in that sense anyway. He said, if you abide in me, just like a vine and branch, if you abide in me and my life abides in you, you'll bring forth fruit. You don't even have to worry about bringing forth fruit. You just have to abide in him. We're being separate. And if you abide in him, guess what? Fruit's going to come forth. But guess what? If you don't abide in him and you continue for a long period of time, it just doesn't happen overnight. Oh, I didn't abide in him, just one. Probably going to be cut off. Anyway, you know, it takes a long time for the life to eventually dry up in a branch that one time flourished. It is not an easy process. This may be hard to believe, but it is not an easy. You see dead limbs and stuff fall down during rainstorms and stuff, and whatever, but it is not an easy overnight process for a limb that once had life and stuff growing all out of it. It is not easy for it to lose the life. Okay. It has to be a long, concerted going away from the life, depending on himself, whatever, I don't care, and looking to self and not looking to the Lord. And then what happens? It's the problem isn't you don't bear fruit. The problem is you cut yourself off from the life and the vine. When you do that, you cut yourself off from the life that brings forth fruit. Right? So the issue never is fruit. The issue is the life. If you don't abide in me, and I in you, you're going to wither. And he doesn't come up and see one that's got green, but it's not doing too good. You cut it off. He says, it's withered, then you cut it off. Why? It doesn't have my life. somebody travel all the way from another state to ask me this question. What? How could God kill all those people in Noah's day? How could he kill all that people? I mean, that's terrible. I mean, he just kills them. They were already dead. They were already dead. They were not born again. They were dead. God knew, because God has more knowledge than we don't, that if they weren't going to accept him, whether they killed them now or let them die of old age, doesn't really make a whole lot of difference. In fact, one way it's better is there's not as much junk going on, but I mean, you know, I mean, they were already dead. He knew through foreknowledge that they weren't going to return. So he saved those that were. But how did he save us? Get in the ark. Get in the ark. Through the death that took place and the resurrection. Were they resurrected? Yes, no. The ark was resurrected. They were in it, so they received the resurrection. But if they weren't in it, guess what? They'd have sunk down to the bottom. Right? Gosh, I get off so much. But I was just thinking, there's a word there. It says they pitch the ark in and out. They pitch. Look that up in the Hebrew. It says atonement. It says atonement. If you look it up in the Hebrew, not in your, but if you look it up, it says atonement. The thing that held the whole thing together was the atonement of Christ. All right. I'm sorry to get off and preach Jesus in other ways. Yeah. But really and truly, it's all the same. Okay. Matthew 22, we're in the neighborhood. Matthew 22, 42. Jesus saith unto them, did you never read the scriptures, which is did you never read the scriptures? The stone which the builders rejected, the same has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, as Martha's and I. See what I mean? The same is the head of the corner. There is, you ain't going to build a house without having that cornerstone. And Jesus, as the same, is the thing that brings stability to the whole house. Is anybody really beginning to see this concept? Not just the, I mean, how really in the scriptures, when it says the same, you can actually see beyond this subject here, the same thing, or, you know, what I'm talking about here is still the fact. You know, that's not what it's saying.
Derek, do you have Mark 8:35 down?
No, I don't.
It's really good when it says, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it.
Now, why didn't it do it the first time? Why didn't it say the same on the first time?
Because it's the same stuff on the second time.
Isn't that cool? You know, we think, oh, how do I know the scriptures you... You know what I mean? How do I know that they are so accurate that it's unbelievable they're so accurate? Yeah. I mean, that could have, that scripture could have messed everything up.
Whosoever, this is in Matthew 5, Matthew 20, it says, whosoever therefore shall bring one of the least of these commandments shall teach him, shall teach him himself, he shall be called least of these commandments, but whosoever shall do them and teach them, same shall be called great. Not even how it is people, you know, like all of us. But that's the same. He's the one that does it, just that he is a great one. Not us.
That was Luke 9:4.
Luke 5:19. And it goes on to say, after verse 20, for I say unto you, except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall know you stand in the heaven. That's the means. You know, the same, his righteousness is greater than all. We think, oh, how can I have greater righteousness? But if we're identified in him, then we have that greater righteousness.
Yeah, we do. Okay, let's see if this is right. Matthew 12:15. Whosoever shall do the will of my Father who is in heaven, the same as my brother and sister and mother. Is that a good one? Okay, so what makes you part of the family? The original seed, the same seed that he is, that everyone else that is of him has received. Right? Because everybody receives the same seed. So if you have the same as my brother and sister. But if you say, now you can miss this scripture, you can make this a legalistic Pharisee type of scripture. You can say, whoever does all the right actions the same, or that person is my brother and sister. And that would be wrong. Whoever does all the right actions, that person is my brother, my sister, my mother. You could not say that way. You have to say, whosoever does the will of my Father. That's not talking about deeds, that's talking about his will. That's talking about, because the same, the whole point of this thing about the same is that he is the total thought concept of God. He is by his nature and therefore will do the will of the Father. But doing the will of the Father is not first. Because doing the will of the Father is not first. There has to be a kindred, and it's more stronger bond than kindred. There has to be a I know what I'm talking about, but I don't think there's human words to say it. I've never been able to really communicate this, but I know it clearly. I mean, usually I can say it pretty verbal, but no way I can do it. There's just no real words that I can find to say, because there is this, we use words of communion, but still, there's more intimacy. This is my beloved son. You've been taken out of the kingdom of darkness and translated into the kingdom of his dear son. I mean, there's this intimacy of relationship. It's not just a official work, though it's certainly official, but it's based on way more than just kind of here's your papers, go on, you're in.
When you say that he yields himself to the heart of the Father, he yields from himself to the heart of the Father, the will.
Yeah, that's it. That you just said it all.
I mean,
I can't even say it. Ricky just says it.
He doesn't.
He's yielding himself to the heart of the Father, but it's not just a yielding as in it is a get. It's a, Jesus said, "I delight to do that will." So it's not just a yielding; it is a embracing and a oneness with the heart of the Father that produces whatever. And you don't even see this, where everybody's always trying to figure out, okay, what's the will of God? What should I do in this situation? And most of the time, I guarantee Jesus didn't want to go, well, wonder what the heart of the Father on this deal is. And wonder what, he knows the heart of the Father. There may be some situations where you look at it and you go, okay, well, I have this situation and I can, slap this person and I can, lay down my life. Pretty clear to me what the heart of the Father is, Well, that's for you and your father.
I was just thinking in the description about the same. I saw one that I thought was interesting that shows how the same, how we have the same, but you see it in another person. And that's Luke 2:25. It says, "Behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him." So there was the sameness. He had the same. It was the same that he was that he was in, that he was waiting for. And
Now you can say, a person can come up and say, listen to what you just said.
You guys are stretching this thing way out of proportion, okay? I mean, come on, every word, all of the angels be that little. It's proof in the pudding right there in that scripture. Most of Israel missed the coming of the Lord, but this man was the same, and therefore he was one of only two or three at the birth of Jesus that actually understood, because he was the same. But if he wasn't, it would have just, he'd have walked back past him just like she walked in there to, you know, having circumcised and all this, walked past a million people, and they all didn't go, that's him! You know, they just walked by, oh, what a cute little baby. Probably people walked up, oh, what a cute little baby. Yeah, it's the Son of God, excuse me, but you don't know that because you're not the same. I tell you what, this is really, really, you know, it's like what Richard was saying, what you're saying there. This really is not a matter of doing. It really isn't. How do you figure that out? The Spirit of God came on him because they're one, and he knew, and he moved with the saints, as the book's going on. And we all want a little manual, not the Bible, but we want a little manual that says, okay, under these situations, do this. And under these situations, never do this. This is what we want. And if we had that, we'd be back under the law. And you should have been born in the Old Testament. You know, and it'd probably been good, because then you'd been killed because you were rebellious. You'd have been stoned for not obeying what your will was that you wanted so bad. And you'd make you go, before this stone, can I go back to the New Testament time?
Yeah, you know, when you said that, it reminds me of what I was reading about Abraham. It says, what shall we say then that Abraham, our father, became flesh and found? There was a founding, a searching out, of coming to an understanding that it was the same, that it wasn't by works, that it was all by the grace of God.
That was my answer to this verse you asked me. No, I said, you know, it says that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He wasn't better. You know, she concluded that he didn't have a sin nature, everybody else did. The woman comparing to that, how God didn't, you know. First of all, if he didn't have a sin nature, he wasn't sin, and he was a perfect and just man in the sense of never did anything wrong, he wouldn't need to find grace. Because you don't need grace if you're perfect. You only need it if you're imperfect. I said this before. Somebody says, I'm a man of faith. I'm a man of this, and I'm a, you know, I'm a man of grace. I mean, I need it so bad, you know. And I don't make void the grace of God. But and apparently neither did Noah. Because he was just as bad in that sense as anybody else by virtue of his nature. But he chose to follow the Lord and to believe. So God says, what do I do? Israel one time, they all sinned, and God sent snakes, and they bit them. Moses went to God and said, heal them. Oh God, heal them. I'm your leader. I'm their leader. Heal them. God said, no, I ain't going to heal them. They don't need healing. The reason why snakes are biting them is because they're sinning, and I sent snakes to show them that they're all snake bits. They're full of poison. That they're all, the snake represents the serpent, which represents Satan. And that's why this is on them. No, what they need is the cross. And then he gave the example of the serpent being hung on a pole. Jesus taking our old sin nature, dying on the cross. And if you whosoever look and believe, shall not perish but have everlasting life. You know what I mean? And so then some, you know, the ones that looked, they got healed. But they didn't get healed. They got killed in Christ. So that's in the Old Testament. Loose cruel stuff, you know, I mean, it's everywhere. The truth is there, but, you know, if you don't have eyes to see, then you pray, Lord, open my eyes. We have a song in church that says, open my eyes, Lord, that I may see Jesus. You don't go, what is love that's not supposed to, or why is God, you know, and so we start saying God's unfair, which already puts you two more steps back. You know what I'm saying? God's unfair, so that puts you two more steps back. Because now you got a wall between you and God. If you don't really trust him, when he is trustworthy, you just believe things about him that weren't true. So now you're going to have to not only fight through what is the real answer here, but overcome these concepts that you keep coming up with every time you get in this situation. your own problems that you believe because you've chosen to believe that God really wasn't fair. And in my opinion, this is my opinion, if he's that bad, he's just that unfair, then quit following him. Don't follow the Lord. What are you, some sort of idiot? Don't follow the Lord. Go find you something good. You know, don't follow the Lord if he's really unfair. And, you know, but I'll go to hell if I follow him.
Well,
if
he's unfair, you're going to go to hell anyway.
Yeah, because he don't like the way you got your jaw fixed. And see, that's real dangerous, because if he's the same and he's unfair, we're all in trouble. So this thing is scaring you to death. You ain't even wanting to teach you this. Well, that's because your concept of the same is wrong. Greg?
Well, you brought concepts about what you really good.
Okay. I wrote, many get bored with the same, but I'm excited.
Oh no, the same?
Yeah. Hey. Because that's stable and that has life. That can manifest more ways than your little variety line apart. Yeah. And so, to really understand him as the same is exciting. To understand the theology behind it is not to know the same, it is to understand the theology behind something that you don't know. Do you understand what I'm saying? So if you can understand the theology behind what we're teaching and not know the same. And so you have some problems, or you'll have some questions, or you whatever. But I'm telling you, this is in the heart of the Father from the beginning and will be there in the end. And if it is boring and nothing to it, it still won't be all there is. However, that's just the wrong concept, because the truth is it is more multifaceted than anything that you could ever get into. Okay, the Bible says, and that's one of the scriptures I brought out earlier, in 1 Corinthians, I think chapter 1, is that we're supposed to speak the same thing. Speak the same. So I wrote this about speaking the same. You may preach one sermon and then another sermon later. But if you preach Jesus, then you've been preaching the same. Right? It is different, but the same. Some get tired of hearing the same thing. You can talk about love once and peace the next time if the Spirit witnesses that it is Christ. Now, once again, it has to really be the same. Because I've been in churches where they'll talk about love, and they'll talk about witnessing, and they'll talk about hating sin, and they'll talk about staying away from leaven, and they'll say, witnessing and then stay away from leaven, and then love, and then they'll say, oh, but you gotta hate sin. It's not the same. You become confused. You go, what do I do? And But when you preach Christ, something bears witness that it doesn't matter what subject you're on, it keeps coming back to Him because He is the total thought concept of God. And God's not going to change His mind. God's not going to change His heart. So, you know, I guess the reason why I say that is I remember going through a time where I was going, well, you know, I mean, I was coming out of some stuff where there's a lot of teaching on healing and gifts and exciting events and all this stuff, and I was kind of wanting to liken that and wanting to lean toward that too. So I was kind of getting upset and going, why is everything got to be Jesus? Yeah. And then I began to realize this, I began to see this, just glimpses of the same, meaning that this was the heart of the Father and what was and is and years to come. And it occurred to me that whether I understand it or not, or this or that, if this is what it's all about, I need to get in the boat. I don't need to be swimming alongside, reaching in the boat, trying to get a can of Coke while I'm with my own fingers. I need to get in the boat with the Lord. And that helped kind of jerk me up and realize, hey, this is it where it's at. You know, my understanding at that moment didn't even comprehend, and I'm sure I didn't barely comprehend it, but this is where it's at. And so what else is there? But not anything. So we're talking about even the same. Speak the same. What words would you use to exhaust Christ? In fact, even today we ran out of words. What words would you use to exhaust Christ? Those whose minds are full of Christ always speak the same thing, regardless of what subject or text that they teach from. I think of, in the book of Acts, Philip was in Samaria, and there was this Ethiopian eunuch that was passing by, and he was in this chariot. He's on his way back to Africa, you know. And God spoke to Philip and said, go join yourself to this guy. And the guy had an Old Testament. He was sitting there reading. He was reading at a certain place in Isaiah. And I could be wrong, but I think it says that at the same place he was reading, he preached Christ. I mean, I'm not sure if it uses the word same, the same. But I know that it says right there where he was reading, he preached Christ. Okay? So he didn't go, oh, well, let me take you over here to the two scriptures that I've spent, I've been following the Lord 10 years, and I found at least two good scriptures. In other words, there was this pressing in so that anywhere you were at, you knew Christ was there. And then Christ could be shared right there where they're reading and asking questions. Those whose minds are full of Christ always speak the same thing regardless of what subject or text they teach them. You didn't have to go find something new. There is this time period that most of you will go through if you haven't already where you're going to always want to learn something new. I've got to have something new. And that's what growth, that's what you call growth. Hearing something new. And we haven't grown in what we have been told. Been growing in what we already have heard. We've heard it, but we don't know it. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. I know what I'm talking
about. What was it you said about you just talking about? You said, oh, it's also worth the price. Places that have gotten off because they've gotten subjects. But safe for you. These are the, steps that make a difference. Jesus Christ is saving you. You're always receiving the truth.
Right.
That's what makes you free.
That's why Dan Allen talked. He said, I think one of the reasons why the Lord is having us guys share, you're not preaching as much or anything, is he said, I think this church got used to just being fed, just pure, all the seeds pulled out and whatever. And he said, now with us teaching, he said, like the last time I taught, I was like, wait a minute, you agree with this, Randy? And all this kind of stuff. He said, it's making people listen more, because if you're chewing on a piece of chicken and there might be a chicken bone in there, you might choke on it, you might be a little more careful to listen a little more carefully. He says, I think the Lord really uses it. I said, I think so too. And because you just, what is precious can become not valuable at all. It can become not, but it is still valuable. You're missing out because you're not treating it as valuable. And that was something that I promised myself I would never do earlier in my walk with the Lord. So that if somebody shares, and this is hard for people to believe, but I believe this is totally the truth in relationship to me. If somebody stands up, and they're brand new Christian, and they say, oh, I'm just glad you And somebody else stands up and they share something that I've already shared. Somebody else stands up and they share something. If it's all from those that love the Lord, it's the same. It doesn't matter to me. I am just as blessed. And I believe even fed, even though I have something that I do, I'm fed because I'm not feeding on the knowledge. I'm feeding on Christ. And I've seen people, and I guess, maybe I got this from me, I'm sure I did, because I didn't get anything else from my mind. The only way I really learned it was something that other people just said. But so I must have, at one point in my walk, somebody young come up and share something with me, and I was 2 or 3, 5 years old in the Lord, and said, I already saw that and walked off. Notice their face, and I must have done that enough times to realize, first of all, that's wrong. That is a real Now, I try not to do that, though I'm sure I've failed at different times. Or people may have misread my looks or my actions, but I know that basically in my heart, I love. I think Sunday night may be a greater blessing to me than most people, because I love hearing. I love hearing people. I mean, I've been told by other people, oh, I don't even do it. People just get up and carry on. It's life to them. It's feeding me, because I'm feeding on the life. Okay, so those on Mars Hill, this is in the book of Acts, there's a place called Mars Hill, and it says that they gather together with nothing more than to hear some new thing. So those on Mars Hill will want to hear something new. Not the same, but something new. There is no new thing under the sun. It says that in Ecclesiastes. There's no, so how are you going to hear something new? There's no new thing under the sun, but the same is always new. Because it's fresh and alive. Always fresh if it is truly the same, or if we are truly receiving the sun. The only thing that gets old is the old creation. You claim you're speaking Jesus, and the body claims it's speaking Jesus, but are you speaking the sun? Because Jesus is the same. Okay, one scripture says, talk about the same spirit, that we have the same spirit. We not only speak the same, but we must have the same spirit. If it is the same thing we speak, it's going to be the same spirit. Because you will speak from your spirit, not from your brain. If your spirit is not the same as the body, then your speaking is not the same. So you have to be one spirit before. Because your heart is part of your spirit. Your heart is part of your spirit. It's like your soul is made up of mind, will, and emotion. Your spirit is made up of one part of that is your heart. And out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth is going to speak. So, it also says to have the same mind. The same mind is more than just like-mindedness. The same mind, the scriptures is more than like-mindedness. Oh, I'm like-minded. I like, you know, certain kind of gloves and certain kind of this and certain kind of that. I mean, that's one of the things that I really do appreciate our body is that we have people with a real diverse kind of taste and stuff. The same mind is more than just like-mindedness. We could have meetings all day and never have the same mind, though we may be going in similar directions. Maybe this is a word to you today, maybe this is from the Lord. If you're going in a similar direction, do you need to quit going in a similar direction and put the same mind? That's what's important.
Yeah, when you said that, that reminds me of the drawing that you had on the board about how our lives intersect, that line going across, and how our lives intersect with that line. And while you're doing that, I was thinking the greater deceptfulness isn't the fact that it intersects, but when somebody gets going in the same direction that's parallel to the life of Christ, and they're able to look over and see the very life of Christ, and it's always parallel to them, and they think that it's the same thing, when it's not the same thing.
Right. We have the Father, we have the Word who is the same. The same is in the beginning with God. Okay, and then down here we have the Scriptures and we have us. Okay? I wrote, we do not get the same mind through searching the Scriptures. Here's the Scriptures. You do not get the same mind by searching the Scriptures. What do you get? You get the mind of Christ by, through the Word, through the Scriptures, seeing the complete thought and concept of God. But if we think by reading the Scriptures and going, okay, well, I agree with that, I agree with this, and I agree with that, and you agree with that, and you agree with that, so we've got the same mind, no, to agree on the same things or similar things or identical things. But until you've seen the same himself, you cannot have this mind in you. And that's what it says. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And that comes from Philippians, where just prior to that, in fact, if you read the book of Philippians, a lot of what he's addressing there is problems between brothers and sisters. And there's this contention between, I think, these two sisters. They're not getting along, and it's causing division in the body, whatever. And so he says, be of the same mind. Be of the, you know, he starts saying, and then in fact, he goes, okay, look, you're probably not getting this, because I'm saying be of the same mind, and you're probably getting, let's get along. Can't we just get along? So he goes, all right, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself no reputation. Humbled himself, came to the man, let that mind be new, became obedient even unto death of the cross. Now we're talking the same mind. You see what I mean? I mean, they could have interpreted what he was saying as, can we just get along here? Well, I guarantee Paul, I'm sorry, I know this, he would not have been happy if they hadn't started getting along. Why?
No. Right.
That wouldn't necessarily have been Christ. Yeah. You know, people getting along. You know, I mean, there are people get along on jobs. There are people that get along, you know, like General Motors or whatever. Is that Christ? No. Yeah. Okay. So that's why Paul's addressing this problem within the church. But if he's going to actually deal with the problem and give them the answer, what is he going to end up with? Christ being crucified. Christ is the same. That's the only way he can really and truly remedy the situation. This is why you find it, oh, you're dealing with husbands and wives, which is the great mystery of speaking Christ, the church, you go, you're dealing with this. Everything he deals with, he ends up goes back to this one. So, look, if you see this conform to this, then you won't have any problems. If you don't see it, then you go, okay, I'm doing the best I can. I have people tell me that all the time. I'm doing the best I can. I think, who cares? I know it's getting that down on the passion. Who cares? You can do the best you can. You know, where's that scripture where it says, when it's in Psalms, it says, man at his best is altogether vanity? You know, you go, well, then I'll just go out and murder everybody. You know, and you say, well, I wouldn't want to encourage that. He might murder me. Oh, and I might just go to heaven instantly. Be the Lord. That'd be terrible. You see, I mean, I wouldn't want to die and go be with Jesus. I wouldn't want to encourage him to not be good, because that would be bad for society. Well, I'm not encouraging him to be good or bad. I'm encouraging him that Christ may be all in you. That's different. And if they interpret that as, oh, well, good, I just don't have to try anymore, so I just won't try. You know, next time you ask me to do my chore, you're deep for me on the floor. I go, oh, didn't I? All right, so we move to the next section called Harmony and the Same. Harmony and the Same. I was referring to 1 Corinthians 12 earlier, where it says there are differences, but they are the same. There are differences, but they are the same. They are all Christ, and Christ is the same. If it is different in method, but the same in substance, then it will complement. And trust me, not only does the church at large not understand this, but this church, and a lot of people in this church do not understand. They don't witness the way I do. I don't think they're God. They don't lead worship the way I would like worship. They don't like, you know what I mean? But this is really the truth. If it is different in method, but the same in substance, then it does complement. It does. But so it, you could say it is the same, but it is certainly not identical. Right? It is not identical. We're not teaching the concept of the same in terms of identical. We are actually opposed to that, because that would not truly be the same, because he manifests in different ways in different people. So that would be going against him. So if it's not identical, but see, we hear this, and so that stabilizes us even more, and everything must be identical to my mind. Of course, my mind must be the mind of Christ. That's wrong. No, I need to know him. I need to have his mind. You need to have his mind. You say, well, you're the leader. You can push your mind. The closer you get to this truth, the more fear of God you walk in. You do not use power, because that's of the kingdom of darkness. You use authority. You do not force your way. You do not insist on your way, because that is not letting this mind be in you. And I guarantee, you do that long enough, and God will cut you off. You say, there's nobody over here. God will cut you off. And that's a fact. God will cut you off. Because he ain't going to let somebody rule over his people very long. And he'll give chances, and he'll warn, and he'll do this. But eventually, he goes, well, that's enough. I mean, you know. So somebody that really understands starts walking in the fear of God, not in a negative way, but in, man, I love the Lord and I love these people, and what, you know, and what they need is the Lord, and they don't need me. You know. So somebody sits up there and says, oh, if I could be the leader, that would be easy. It's twice as hard. Because now you got everybody wanting their own way, and your old man inside of you wanting his own way. And if you do it wrong, it filters down to everybody. You know? So you go, God, I got to be right now. Before, I only had to be right for me. And who cares if I messed up? And now, I can't mess up all these people. I got to know the Lord. Oh, God. And you just get down and you're going to stay humble. You really do learn to walk softly. Okay, so, but if it is different in substance, we said if it is different in method but the same substance, it will complement. But if it is different in substance, then it will bring division, bitterness, and ruin. If it is indeed not the same, then it is of something else and will not be part of us and will have to be separated from us because it is not the same as us. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
First John,
yeah. You probably heard me share that before. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have no doubt continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us.
I was here, Carrie, when I can't wait to graduate. Go out from us.
What? You know what I mean? I mean, like, we're looking at the, what are we looking at? I mean, we need to look at the truth. We need to look at the truth and not look at time, place, space, all these things that really, if they rule, you know, you follow the Lord and go anywhere you want. As long as you follow the Lord. That's the goal. I mean, Jesus, when he walked there, he followed the Lord. Led him right to the cross. The same is greater than being in harmony together. The same is greater than being in harmony together. Okay, the last one is walk by the same. We are to walk by the same rule. Philippians 3:16 says that. We are to walk by the same rule. That means we can get walk by the same. Philippians 3:16. We're to walk by the same rule. So that means we are not to write down a rule and all walk by it. Now, this may be hard, but every rule that we've got, I have tried to take before the Lord. Now, there may be rules that I have had to do. But there are rules that you see as arbitrary or ignorant or whatever, that I guarantee the Lord was behind it. Now, sometimes times change and seasons change and time to jump certain rules. And that's a fact. But I want you to know that if the Spirit was behind it, then the Spirit will motivate you and cause you to not keep the rule, but fulfill. In other words, the rule will never be a problem. You'll go the extra mile beyond that, but you only have to look at the rules to do that. You know. Somebody was telling me the other day, well, we need to, you know, you're fixing to meet with Randy, but we need Randy to do so-and-so, da-da-da-da. And I said, you know, the person said, well, Randy's the leader. So don't you be telling Jesus. This person didn't say this, but this person thought, man, he's submitted to the Spirit of Christ. And you'll know the right. You'll know the rule in this situation, not rule written down. Know what to do. And that's true. It's not, there's not, you know, I mean, I didn't just come up with 20 commandments. I don't know as many as in the book, or 150. I don't know. You know, it's okay. You know, there's a spirit behind everything, and here's the deal that's just as frustrating to me as the other. If somebody breaks all those rules, that's frustrating. If somebody keeps them all but doesn't have the spirit of it, I want you to know this honest truth, that's just as frustrating. In fact, it is just as frustrating. It really is. Because it is not keeping rules, it is walking by the same. But you have to have rules, because how would you know if somebody's not living by the same? The rule is like the law. It points out the snakes, and we go, turn the light off! Wicked law, wicked rules, wicked rules. If we didn't pointing out that you're not walking by the same.
This probably applies to somebody in this room, at least one person. There she is.
I say it applies to me because I tend to be a person who keeps rules, but you think you're doing really good, but you don't even know that it's not Christ because you're living in this. And so you miss it, fortunate, you don't see the church all because it looks so good, whereas if you're totally not, then it just applies to breaking the rules you think, but maybe if you're more messed up and you manifest that one, then you're more likely to go, maybe I need to look at this if you're wrong here, but you look so good all the time, or you can lose to yourself, and you're giving out to everybody else, but you know, just something to myself, and I was really proud of the shaking of the fit to myself, but that wasn't true.
Well, I know one thing, there's a real tendency with people in leadership too, is to, what I call building the nest. But what they do is they convert the rules from the spirit of the same to them. And they make a nest, they make it easy to live within those rules the way that they enforce it, because the rules are actually bent to fit them. And the truth is, when they're not obeying the rules, they're not jumping themselves and saying, hey, you should have been in by some sort, da da da, or whatever. So there is no contrast, so that they don't grow, so that they go for a long time. Not only don't grow, they self-justify, which puts them way further back, so that, and then they wonder when they see other people growing in the Lord, they go, what are they growing? I've been here longer. That's this girl. Hello, you circumvented the same, you know, and, you know, what else? It's just a bunch of stupid rules. Meant to be Christ, or to at least show what is or what isn't. And will work. The total environment will work, because I believe it's based on the scripture. And I was telling somebody the other day, the problem is, we don't have a total. We never have that, because we don't have enough people that understand this to enforce it, to make it real, so that we would all grow. We just all lose and hang loose and whatever, don't, you know, whatever. So there's no contrast, and there's no, you know, when the leaders are all doing their thing and nobody's speaking the truth, it's like somebody does something wrong. You sit down and you say, okay, here's how that is in Christ. You don't sit down and go, now the rules are, and you wrote the rules, and get out of here, baby. You know, whatever. I mean, or whatever. You know, there's so many different ways of doing it. So with time, it becomes an institution, which I warned about. But if enough people actually begin to see the truth, some who are standard bearers, I remember seeing that in the Song of Solomon. Beautiful picture says, my beloved is a, there's a word that it uses there, and I looked it up in Hebrew. My beloved is a chief, oh, I think it said chief among men. And I looked it up and said he's a standard bearer. And I just went, oh, because the standard, this is what this represents. And you're going into battle and you're saying, there's what we stand for, and everybody else can see it. And people are falling, the standard bearer stays up, man. Everybody goes, yeah, no, man. You know, but if nobody stands up for the standard, everybody goes, where do we go? Or, you know, what's going on? But it's not always easy to be a standard bearer. It's easier just to be one of the crowd and go, okay, there's the standard bearer. He lifts up the truth and we'll all follow him. I think it said he's the cheapest among 10,000, and that word was standard there. And I thought, man, I want to lift up the Lord if nobody else does. But when I say that, apparently a lot of people go, well, good, we ain't. So that's good. You're one among 10,000, praise the Lord, we got one. You know, instead of all of us being standard bearers. So I've got an axe to grind. You know, I mean, I just feel that there's some real areas that God is wanting to do, is has wanted for a long, 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 long time. That he's really wanted to do work in us here. And you know, quit having a little whatever with God here. This is only this that doesn't flow down and bring forth the truth. I mean, if we, you know, Paul said if we believe it, you know, in Christ, let us walk in it. I mean, if we believe this, let it become real. I'm just talking about it, and then form something that is absolutely contrary. supposed to, you know, if you buy, it'll become void. But, I mean, that's still better than calling something that's not as though it were in that sense of the measures. So that's, I mean, you know, so, but I mean, the best, you know, good, better, best, never, better, best, always make it good, better, any better, best. The best would be to know the truth and to bring it into this realm, you know, manifest, be a standard, stand up, or go look, you know, I mean, I ain't nobody and nothing. When I was in Bible school, I was a nobody. But, you know, I would say to somebody, and I'm sorry, but they'd say something, and it wasn't Christ, and the offense to me was not that I'm some sort of leader, but this isn't Christ, and we can't do this because you're part of me, and if I just let you go, then this is perverting me and us, and it'll never be. And this can't happen. Come here. We got it. Well, who do you think you are? I tell you what, man, nobody. But Christ is everything. And, you know, you know, and then you start, you know, please, wake up, it's got to be, don't you see what I'm saying? And they go, you're just a little smart, aren't you? I told them, hey, you little twerp, 17-year-old kid, we've been here for 40 days of this time. We're scared blind, man, what are you talking about? You're just smarting off. No, I ain't. You can do the same. Let's go. I'll go against him. You look at you. I go against him in the name of, not of my name. A lot different from this one, going out to the devil and quoting. This is the sword of the Spirit. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. And that takes your head off. What happened? This doesn't work. Your stuff doesn't work. This stuff works. Because this is the truth, and the truth will make you great. And the truth will make something good. And of course, the idea behind it is, you know, you don't have a building until you've added several of these things. You know what I mean? Oh, we're a habitation of God, and we're in a building, we're gathered, but we're a habitation. Snakes throw blocks out there in the yard, and they pop snakes will inhabit that. They crawl all in there, rats and everything that get in there. You're building up a building of people, of God will inhabit the building. Built up, not just gathered together. So, but it takes more than one, and you can have seven. You still don't have a building. So you go, okay, this is it. This is where we're going. New man, this one. This is the truth. You know, this isn't just concepts. This isn't just, you know, I remember 20 years ago or 25 ago, that when I came up with the idea about having new creation, I didn't even come up with it. Those of you who know how this thing started, God started it, even against what I wanted. And then we ended up calling it new creation because this is supposed to be made after this image. And then being in Christ is a new creation. We said we can't. Can we call it anything less than the spiritual reality of what it must become? Mary, that thing that is born in you, I want you to call it Jesus. Don't call it Ralph or Norton or something. Call it Jesus because it's Jesus. Call it new creation. Jerry?
Yeah, and as she's talking about that, I might be, you know, a little off to saying this, but, you know, that truth must be birthed in us.
Yep.
And once it's birthed in us, it's seeing the truth and knowing the truth, and anything less than that, what will happen will be dictating the rule of truth.
Right, that's exactly right.
And that's not what it is. But if it's birthed in you, the truth is birthed in you, you see the truth, then your life will manifest that truth. And if you're not exactly always saying, walking up to saying people, it will be manifested in you, and other people will be able to see the truth that's being birthed in you. You know, and the reason I say that is because sometimes a difficulty of knowing what to say, when to say, But if you know the truth, if the truth is birthed in you, you see the truth, sometimes it's not even necessary to stay.
That's exactly right.
And I wanted to bring out that distinction.
Because it's based on life.
It's based on life, and it's not based on anything else, trying to bring out a tool of truth. Now the Abraham and his seed were the That's how you get into there. It's through the promise of faith. And so you receive the seed, which is Christ, through the righteousness of faith. And that's the only way. You just step into faith, receiving the promises by faith. It's not that you do the promises of faith.
Well, our response is either going to be fear or faith. And if it's fear, then we're looking at us and we're measuring ourselves with the same. If we don't measure it, there's only one possible conclusion. I don't measure it.
But you're one with the saints.
But faith says, hey, I'm one with him, I'm in him. I don't have to attain to anything here. I just need to continue in the word. I just need to abide in him as much as I know to do. And, I think when the Lord sends for the child, there are certain things that we can do. I mean, when you bring up the standard bearer, I mean, there is a possibility. I never heard anybody say that, but I saw the truth in the scriptures of Song of Solomon. When I saw the truth, I said, man, I don't want to just be with the right crowd, marching along and going, I want to be a standard, but I want people to, wave far up behind everywhere else, the going gets tough. Remember Jehovah Nisi, the Lord is my banner? That's what Jehovah Nisi means, the Lord is my banner. When Moses' arms would get tired, the banner would come down, they would start losing. But when he would hold it up higher, they would start winning the battle. Of course, the banner is the Lord, so somebody's got to hold it up. And so Moses was holding it up, and his arms got tired, and Aaron and some of the others came over, and they said, our part is not going to be out there to fight the enemy. Our part is going to hold your arms up while you hold the banner up, and we're going to hold it up so that everybody can see it. And when they did, strengthened his arms, then the battle was turned and they won. And they called the place Jehovah Nisi. That's where they came. It's a great truth. There's any number of places in there, but to me, I saw this in Song of Solomon and I said, man, I want it. And I don't really believe God just. And this is my opinion. I don't believe God just grabbed rings. You're going to know the truth and the depth of the truth, and you're going to be like Paul or something. I don't think that happened at all. First of all, I'm not even like Paul. I'm not even close to anybody with the Word of God. The closest I am to Paul is he said he was the least of all. I think what happened to me is that as I heard, maybe this Chris got me, but I'm just saying that I would hear something and I would go, I want that. I want to be with you. I mean, I'd see all these people around the table with Jesus, and John laying his head on his chest, and I go, the Spirit of God says you can get as close as you want. You know what I mean? And then I ended up not laying on his chest, but like falling in him, being in him, being one with him. But it was a process of moving closer. You know what I'm saying? Closer and closer to the multitude, the 500, then the 120 on the day of Pentecost, then the 70 that were sent out, then the 12, then the 3 that Jesus began, then the 1, John lands at, and finally the 1 in him, and you are the 1, and that's it. But at each step that the Lord would woo me, I would answer. I mean, I wouldn't go, I don't understand this one vein of faking yourself out. I mean, I do, but I don't. I've never wanted to fake myself, but even when I was a sinner. But I just don't understand that really. I've always wanted to just go, okay. If the Lord says, come, I've always wanted to go, okay, I'm going to come. I'm not going to go, okay, let's just say we did, okay? Let's don't say we did. Okay, I came to the Lord. No, you didn't. You just said you did. I wanted to not come, and I was like this too. The Lord told me this when I was 20 years old. That the Lord, he gave the parable of the two sons. And one son said, go out and work my fields, and I'll do it. And he just did it. And the other one said, go do it. And he said, I'm not going to do it. And he get up and go do it. The Lord says, you're lying to that. That's exactly how you want it. Because I tell you to do something, you go, no, I'm not going to do it. And they case, I would tell the Lord. I mean, I would just tell the Lord. You know, I would look at it and walk up, pretend my whole life I would do it. I mean, I would just go, no. I love you and I hate to tell you no, but no. I'm not going to do it. And then one thing you learned with me is that once I said that, it drew some lines. It drew some lines on the inside of it. And then you're sitting there and you walk somewhere else. Wait a minute. Reconsidering now. You know, and if I'd done that once, I'd probably done it a million times. I mean, in 25 years, I'd probably done it a million times. No! God, even after I say it, kind of, God, what, Randy, why are you even taking the time to say no? You know you're going to do it! You know? So, you know, of course, sometimes I have to run through all this stuff. Nobody else is doing it! Well, you know, why do you always come to me to do it? And it always comes down because you know, the Father is on that, because you're my son. And I do it not because I do it because I'm a son. You're right. How did you want it done? Where did you want it? How much? You know, because I do want the heart of the Father. Now, I'm not perfect. But I still say no. But you know, most of the stuff that I've said no to the Lord on, that we have not yet got settled in, I'd walk right up to him and go, I love you on this and this and this point. You know, right here, I've said no. He goes, I know. He doesn't go, my God, you're rotten, He always gives me that look or that sense of, but I'm your brother and I have ways of dealing with it. You know, I just kind of, I know, but you don't, but it hadn't dealt now, so, you know, making sure that there's still no on this. And you go, I know. But this thing of, you know, oh, yes, Lord, yes, and I want you and I want to go with you and, you know, and then, you know, walking off and really saying no one inside and saying I want you, which is not good. I don't think it matters to the Lord. He's going to deal with you the same way. But I think it matters to